I'm very moved to see so many people and friends and strangers and luminaries, and it's really marvelous, and welcome, and thank you. Also, I guess I will say, please turn off your phones, and we'll get going. As you guys probably know, Walt Whitman volunteered as a nurse in the Union hospitals during and just following the Civil War. And after this week's upheavals in healthcare, and with Whitman on my mind anyway because of this event, I went back and read some of Specimen Days, his memoir that describes that time. In it, he praises surgeons and laments the suffering of veterans, both boys and men. And it's striking how frequently acts of reading and writing are part of the care and solace that Whitman and others offered to these folks he called cases of the worst and most incurable wounds, obstinate illness, and poor fellows who have no homes to go to. Another nurse, Julia Wheelock Freeman, recalled that she seldom went empty-handed, taking cooked tomatoes or stewed fruit, chicken broth, pickles, butter, cheese, jelly, hot tea, oranges, lemons, fruit, clothing, and reading matter. What I think that all of us here today share is a belief in the power of language to bring clarity and intimacy and memory to bear as we try to move forward in a divided and wounded political time. I also believe that there's a kind of wild hope in resistance. Wild, by which I mean not rational and not easy and not sentimental, or not sentimental in a treacly way. And I think that that hope comes up in us when we see someone's appetite for cruelty or their capacity for indifference. And when we see one or the other or both of those things, we want viscerally to reject it or to replace it with something better. Resistance as an act sounds negative, but in my experience, we actually move to action when we feel a yes arising in response to someone else's no. Soon, you guys are going to see, sort of rotating through on the screen back here, some images and the names and URLs, although they may or may not be legible, but there's little papers that you can take with you. But information about organizations that have been recommended and endorsed by a number of the readers who will be performing today. They're local organizations, national and international organizations who work in all kinds of ways to help others, those most vulnerable and those most at risk. Last week, the Center for the Future of Arizona released some statistics about our state. We continue to fall in the bottom quarter of U.S. states when they are ranked for their civic health. In 48 states, you are more likely to be helped by a neighbor if you experience some kind of need, like a flat tire or the birth of a child, than you are here in Arizona. And actually, we rank 51st in our willingness to attend a public meeting. Like in Guam, they get out there, but we don't do it. Now, here we are. We're at a public meeting. You guys, I'm preaching to the converted. I understand this. But I'm going to tell you a few more of these statistics anyway. Fewer Arizonans vote than is the average for most U.S. states. Fewer of us volunteer. Fewer of us contact or visit with our elected officials or make charitable contributions. The groups that you'll see in the rotation on the screen, maybe one of them will call out to you. Maybe you'll consider donating some money or volunteering alongside or going to a meeting or an event with them. Say yes. I hope that everyone who's here today will give something as a result of today's event. We want absolutely to be here in fellowship with each other. We need also, as Whitman would say, to tend outward, as in take care of, or tend, as in lean that way. We can each do our part to lift our state out of the bottom quartile of the nation. Today, on Martin Luther King's birthday, we are called by the tremendous Writers Resist movement. It's not even 2 months old, and there are more than 90 events taking place around the world, some simultaneous with us right now, like probably a lot of them are going on elsewhere as we speak. Some of them are in Singapore and Zurich and London and Hong Kong and all over the United States. In fact, we were initially Arizona Writers Resist, or Phoenix Writers Resist, and then there wasn't anything else. And so then we said, oh, we better be Arizona. And now Flag has an event. They're in progress, starting in about 45 minutes. So anyway, there's a lot of stuff going on. And the idea is for everyone who's participating to reinaugurate their commitment to the ideals of democracy and freedom of expression. And it seems like a good day on which to do that. And the readers are not going to do big introductions. They may or may not tell you who they are when they come up, but they're just going to come and do their thing. And you can ask us about it later if you need to. The first reader, though, I will tell you is Leah Marche.
Okay, I am short then, am I? Let's see. So I'm supposed to have like 3 to 5 minutes, and I'm supposed to open with Martin Luther King, so I do not know how that is going to happen, but we're going to get through it. Darkness cannot drive out darkness, only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate, only love can do that. The ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at times of challenge and controversy. Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. The time is always right to do what is right. We are not makers of history, we are made by history. We must learn to live together as brothers or perish together as fools. I have decided to stick with love. Hate is too great a burden to bear. So there's this speech Martin Luther King gave in London, December 7th, 1964. 3 days later, he would receive the Nobel Peace Prize. I want to talk with you mainly about our struggle in the United States. And before taking my seat, talk about some of the largest struggles in the whole world and some of the more difficult struggles in places like South Africa. But there is a desperate, poignant question on the lips of people all over our country and all over the world. I get it almost everywhere I go and almost every press conference. It is a question of whether we are making any real progress in the struggle to make racial justice a reality in the United States of America. And whenever I seek to answer that question, on the one hand, I seek to avoid an undue pessimism. On the other hand, I seek to avoid a superficial optimism. And I try to incorporate or develop what I consider a realistic position by admitting on the one hand that we have made many significant strides over the last few years in the struggle for racial justice. But by admitting that, before the problem is solved, we still have numerous things to do and many challenges to meet. And it is this realistic position that I would like to use as a basis for our thinking together tonight as we think about the problem in the United States. We have come a long, long way, but we have a long, long way to go before the problem is solved. Now, the legal history of racial segregation had its beginning in 1896. Many people feel that racial segregation had been a reality in the United States a long, long time, but the fact is that this was a rather recent phenomenon in our country, just a little better than 60 years old, and it has its legal beginning with the decision known as the Plessy versus Ferguson decision, which said in substance that separate but equal facilities could exist, and it made the doctrine of separate but equal the law of the land. We all know what happened as a result of the old Plessy doctrine. There was always the strict enforcement of the separate without the slightest intention to abide by the equal, and the Negro ended up being plunged into the abyss of exploitation where he experienced the bleakness of nagging injustice. Then something happened. President Kennedy had to have stood before the nation and said in eloquent terms, the problem which we face in the area of civil rights is not a merely political issue, it is not merely an economic issue, it is at bottom a moral issue. It is as old as the scriptures and as modern as the Constitution. It is a question of whether we will treat our Negro brothers as we ourselves would be treated. President Lyndon Johnson got to work. He started calling congressmen and senators in and started meeting day in and day out with influential people in the country and making it clear that this bill had to pass, and as a tribute to the late President Kennedy, but not as a tribute to the late President Kennedy, but also as a tribute to the greatness of the country and as an expression of its dedication to the American dream. I mentioned that racial segregation is about dead in the United States, but it's still with us. There's another form of segregation coming up. It's coming up through housing discrimination, joblessness, and the de facto segregation in public schools. And so the ghettoized conditions that exist make for many problems, and it makes for a hardcore de facto segregation that we must grapple with on a day-to-day basis. But certainly, we all know that if democracy is to live in any nation, segregation must die. In the final analysis, racial discrimination must be uprooted from American society and from every society because it is morally wrong. There are those individuals who argue that only time can solve the problem of racial injustice in the United States, in South Africa, or anywhere else. You've got to wait on time. The only answer that I can give to that myth is that time is neutral. It can be used either constructively or destructively. And I must honestly say to you that I'm convinced that the forces of ill will have often used time much more effectively than the forces of goodwill. And somewhere along the way, it is necessary to see that human progress never rolls in on the wheels of inevitability. It comes through the tireless efforts and the persistent work of dedicated individuals, and so we must help time. And we must realize that the time is always ripe to do right. This is so vital. This is so necessary. Another myth is that a great deal in our nation, and I'm sure in other nations in the world, is the idea that you can't solve the problems in the realm of human relations through legislation. You have to change the heart. If we're going to get this problem solved in America and all over the world, ultimately people must change their hearts and where they have their prejudices. It may be true that you can't legislate integration, but you can legislate desegregation. It may be true that morality can't be legislated, but behavior can be regulated. It may be true that the law can't change the heart, but it can restrain the heartless. It may be true that the law can't make a man love me, but it can restrain him from lynching me, and I think that's pretty important also. I still go on to believe it, because I'm convinced that it is love that makes the world go round. And somehow this kind of love can be a powerful force for change. I'm not talking about a weak love. I'm not talking about emotional bosh here. I'm not talking about some sentimental quality. I'm not talking about an affectionate response. It would be nonsense to urge oppressed people to love their violent oppressors in an affectionate sense, and I have never advised that. When Jesus said, love your enemies, I'm happy he didn't say, like your enemies, because it's pretty difficult to like some people. But love is greater than like. There are certain words in every academic discipline that soon become stereotypes and cliches. Every academic discipline has its technical vocabulary. Modern psychology has a word that is probably used more than any other word in modern psychology. It's the word maladjusted. You see, it may be well that our world is in need at this time for a new organization, the International Association for the Advancement of Creative Maladjustment. Men and women who will be as maladjusted as the prophet Amos, who in the midst of the injustices of his day would cry out in words that echo across the centuries, let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. May I say to you that I still believe that mankind will rise up to the occasion, in spite of the darkness of the hour, in spite of the difficulties of the moment, in spite of these days of emotional tension, when the problems of the world are gigantic in extent and chaotic in detail, I still have faith in the future, and I still believe that we can build this society of brotherhood and the society of peace.
Thank you. And my contribution to Writers Resist is an assemblage of voices. And these voices are mostly poets, but some are not. And I'm going to just give the name of each of the voices at the end before I move on to the next one. We the people of the earth, in order to form a more harmonious union, establish and seek justice, peace, promote and respect for all living and inanimate beings, and to secure blessings and posterity for all. We the people respect the earth through prayer, song, and ceremony. Section 1. Ikea ate. This is the land. It is our land, your life. my life, life, kea, nasan, ni ayol, ina. Land, Mother Earth, your breath, living. You have to fight by working. You have to fight by working for the land and the people. Compassion for all the people. Love for all the people. Sure, it's hard. Sure, it's not easy working for the people and the land. To fight for the people and the land. Simon Ortiz. Section 2. This is why we keep the names, and that is why we keep the words to understand our relationship to the whole and our role on the path of life. We must understand our responsibility. We only take what we need and we leave the rest. We always give thanks for what we were given. Winona LaDuke. Section 3. We cannot preserve our nations unless we take action to restore pride in our traditions, achieve economic self-sufficiency, develop independence of mind, and display courage in defense of lands and rights. Only by committing ourselves to these goals can we hope to look into the future and see ourselves re-emerging as people ready to take our rightful places in the world. Ta'aika Aika Alfred. Section 4. There needs to be unity. One has to believe in unity. If we don't take care of it, we will destroy it, and that destruction will return to us in the future. This is how I think about it. Alfred Peaches, Navajo Code Talker. Section 5. Remember the sky you were born under. Know each of the stars' stories. Remember the moon. Know who she is. Remember the sun's birth at dawn. That is the strongest point of time. Remember sundown and the giving away to night. Remember the earth whose skin you are. Red earth, black earth, yellow earth, white earth, brown earth, we are earth. Remember the plants, trees, animal life, all have their tribes, their families, their histories too. Talk to them, listen to them. They are alive poems. Remember, you are all people, and all people are you. Remember, you are this universe, and this universe is you. Joy Harjo. Done in the presence of the four directions. Thank you.
My name is HB with Home-Based Poetry. And this is a piece written by a genius, lyrical genius 50 years ago for, it speaks to today like nothing. It's just amazing. Langston Hughes. Let America be America again. Not great again, but America again. Let America be America again. Let it be the dream it used to be. Let it be the pioneer on the plain, seeking a home where he himself is free. America was never America to me. Let America be the dream the dreamers dreamed. Let it be that great, strong land of love, where never kings connive nor tyrants scheme that any man be crushed by one above. It was never America to me. Oh, let my land be a land where liberty is crowned with no false patriotic wreath, but opportunity is real and life is free. Equality is in the air we breathe. There's never been equality for me, nor freedom in this homeland of the free? Say, who are you that mumbles in the dark? And who are you that draws your veil across the stars? I am the poor white, fooled and pushed apart. I am the Negro bearing slavery scars. I am the red man driven from the land. I am the immigrant clutching the hope I seek and finding only the same old stupid plan of dog eat dog, of mighty crush the weak. I am the young man full of strength and hope, tangled in that ancient endless chain of profit, power, gain, of grab the land, of grab the gold, of grab the ways of satisfying need, of work the men, of take the pay, of owning everything for one's own greed. I am the farmer, bondsman to the soil. I am the worker sold to the machine. I am the Negro servant to you all. I am the people, humble, hungry, mean. Hungry yet today despite the dream. Beaten yet today, oh pioneers. I am the man who never got ahead. The poorest worker bartered through the years. Yet I'm the one who dreamt our basic dream in the old world while still a serf of kings, who dreamt a dream so strong, so brave, so true, that even yet its mighty daring sings. In every brick and stone, in every furrow turned, that's made America the land it has become. Oh, I'm the man who sailed those early seas in search of what I meant to be my home. For I'm the one who left dark Ireland's shore and Poland's plain and England's grassy lea. And torn from Black Africa's strand, I came to build a homeland of the free. The free? Who said the free? Not me. Surely not me. The millions on relief today, the millions shot down while we strike, the millions who have nothing for our pay, for all the dreams we've dreamed and all the songs we've sung and all the hopes we've held and all the flags we've hung. The millions who have nothing for our pay except the dream that's almost dead today. Oh, let America be America again. The land that never has been yet, and yet must be. The land where every man is free. The land that's mine, the poor man's, the Indians, the Negroes, me. Who made America? Whose sweat and blood, whose faith and pain, whose hand on that foundry, whose plow in the rain? Must bring back our mighty dream again. Sure, call me any ugly name you choose. The steel of freedom does not stain from those who live like leeches on the people's lives. We must take back our land again. America. Oh yes, I say it plain. America never was America to me. And yet I swear this oath, America will be. Out of the rack and ruin of our gangster death, the rape and rot of graft and stealth and lies, we the people must redeem the land, the mines, the plants, the rivers, the mountains and the endless plain. All the stretch of these great green states and make America again.
So I selected two readings, one from Hillary Clinton's remarks to the UN Fourth World Conference, and one from Shirley Chisholm's Equal Rights for Women, which was a speech made in the House of Representatives. So Clinton's speech was made in 1995 and Chisholm's was made in 1969. And I think it's incredible how much they speak to each other and how they are still speaking to us today. Couple of brief bios, just in case you do not know. Hillary Clinton is a dedicated lifetime politician and activist, a former Secretary of State, and the first female nominee by a major political party for the office of President of the United States. Sure. Shirley Chisholm was an American politician, educator, and author, and the first African-American woman elected to the United States Congress. She was also the first black candidate for a major party's nomination for president and the first woman to run for the Democratic Party's nomination. So they are both total badasses. I will be reading Hillary Clinton.
And I will be doing Shirley Chisholm.
Hello. By gathering here, we are focusing world attention on issues that matter most in our lives, the lives of women and their families, access to education, healthcare, jobs and credit, the chance to enjoy basic legal and human rights, and to participate fully in the political life of our countries.
Hello. I wish to introduce today a proposal that has been before every Congress for the last 40 years and that sooner or later must become part of the basic law of the land, the Equal Rights Amendment.
There are some who question the reason for this conference. Let them listen to the voices of women in their homes, neighborhoods, and workplaces. There are some who wonder whether the lives of women and girls matter to the economic and political progress around the globe. Let them look to the women gathered here. It is conferences like this that compel governments and peoples everywhere to listen, look, and face the world's most pressing problems.
Let me note and try to refute two of the commonest arguments that are offered against the amendment. One is that women are already protected under the law and do not need legislation. Existing laws are not adequate to secure equal rights for women. Sufficient proof of this is the concentration of women in lower-paying, menial, unrewarding jobs and their incredible scarcity in the upper-level jobs. If women are already equal, why is it such an event whenever one happens to be elected to Congress?
The great challenge of this conference is to give voice to women everywhere whose experiences go unnoticed. Women comprise more than half the world's population, 70% of the world's poor, and two-thirds of those who are not taught to read and write. We are the primary caretakers for the world's children and elderly. Yet, much of the work we do is not valued, not by economists, not by historians, not by popular culture, not by government leaders.
It is obvious that discrimination exists. Women do not have the opportunities that men do. And women that do not conform to the system, who try to break with the accepted patterns, are stigmatized as odd and unfeminine. The fact is that a woman who aspires to be chairman of the board or a member of the House does so for exactly the same reason as any man. Basically, these are that she thinks she can do the job, and she wants to try.
We need to understand that there is no one formula for how women should lead our lives. That is why we must respect the choices that each woman makes for herself and her family. Every woman deserves the chance to realize her own God-given potential. But we must recognize that women will never gain full dignity until their human rights are respected and protected.
A second argument often heard against the Equal Rights Amendment is that it would eliminate legislation that many states and the federal government have enacted, giving special protection to women, and that it would throw the marriage and divorce laws into chaos.
If if only, right?
Yeah.
It is a violation of human rights when babies are denied food or drowned or suffocated or their spines broken simply because they are born girls. It is a violation of human rights when women and girls are sold into the slavery of prostitution for human greed, and the kinds of reasons that are used to justify this practice should no longer be tolerated. It is a violation of human rights when women are doused with gasoline, set on fire, and burned to death because their marriage dowries are deemed too small. It is a violation of human rights when individual women are raped in their own communities, and when thousands of women are subjected to rape as a tactic or prize of war. It is a violation of human rights when the leading cause of death worldwide among women ages 14 to 44 is the violence they are subjected to in their own homes by their own relatives. It is a violation of human rights when young girls are brutalized by the painful and degrading practice of genital mutilation. It is a violation of human rights when women are denied the right to plan their own families, and that includes being forced to have abortions or being sterilized against their own will.
As for marriage laws, they are due for a sweeping reform, and an excellent beginning would be to wipe the existing ones off the books. Regarding special protection for working women, I cannot understand why it should be needed. Women need no protection that men do not need. What we need are laws to protect working people, to guarantee them fair pay, safe working conditions, protection against sickness and layoffs, and provision for dignified, comfortable retirement. Men and women need these equally. That one sex needs protection more than the other is a male supremacist myth, as ridiculous and unworthy of respect as the white supremacist myths that society is trying to cure itself of at this time.
If there is one message that echoes forth from this conference, let it be that human rights are women's rights, and women's rights are human rights, once and for all. Let us not forget that among those rights are the right to speak freely and the right to be heard. Let this conference be our and the world's call to action. Let us heed that call so we can create the world in which every woman is treated with respect and dignity, every boy and girl loved and cared for equally, and every family has the hope of a strong and stable future. That is the work you see before you. That is the work before all of us who have a vision of the world we want to see. The time is now. We must move beyond rhetoric. We must move beyond recognition of problems to working together to have the common efforts build that common ground we hope to see. God's blessing on you, your work, and all who will benefit from it. Godspeed.
Godspeed, and thank you
very much.
It is not uncommon in my line of work to witness a child shake as they read a poem for the first time inside of a classroom. But yesterday I was not inside of a classroom. Yesterday I was inside of a federal prison on the yard where self-proclaimed Pisces, Peckerwoods, and Crips conduct business against the backdrop of razor wire fences. On this particular occasion, inmates listened as 16 of the 35 men I taught in poetry workshops the previous week spilled their stories onto a single microphone. And the last to read was a man named C. His legs shook with nerves, his neck scar glamorous enough to be featured on TV during a special about gangs. Content designed to keep suburban viewers amazed as if the corporations they work for ain't on some gangster shit, please. T's bullet wounds dip like fingers in wet sand against his body. I stand behind him and watch as he reads. He is the shyest light in my classroom of convicts, where the eyes of these men follow me each day as I write on the board a dim glow trapped in their gazes, concealing all the caged memories of their childhoods, where the majority of them were raised to believe that they were mistakes. And a few bad choices along the way landed them in this place. Seems like their whole lives been misshaped. Somehow C's legs shake with purpose, nervous as he speaks about his life. He is deathly afraid of what we're all afraid of. Exposing ourselves in front of a set of eyes that just might redefine us with their judgment. Explaining ourselves to a room of people who may not listen, who may not understand, who just might dismiss our humanity by labeling us bad or no good, or bad and no good, or dangerous, or black and dangerous and bad and no good, or poor, or less, or poor, or less, or disposable, like a body in Ferguson, Missouri, if only you could see. All of our reflections trapped in the tremble rushing through C's veins as each word tumbles out of his mouth like a gas canister filled with tulips, like hollowed out grenades filled with lilacs thumping through the eardrums of 1,000 inmates standing on the yard, standing and listening. Yeah, listening. An audience as warm as any room of humans willing to love.
All my like old professors are here, so I'm like super nervous and stuff. Yeah. Was it good? This is a poem called Bujorquez on the removal of ethnic studies from Arizona classrooms. I teach Desi poetry at an elementary school in Phoenix where most 9-year-olds have parents that dress the Somali way or tell stories the Bosnian way or cook food the Mexican way. Parents who live the way they once lived someplace else, hiding with children in their arms. Desi is embarrassed to say her last name because I am a teacher and this is a school where no one can pronounce the last names of parents. I fail and then finally pronounce her last name correctly, Bujorquez. She smiles with that smile I can't keep her from hiding with her hands. I'm still nervous, so it's crazy. Also, like, my printer broke today, and, like, I know I'm going to, like, an academic reading. People value paper, you know? And I gotta read on my phone. Sorry. But my mother sent me this poem. I was like, I don't know what I'm gonna read, whatever. My mom's a really dope, educated kind of woman, and she sent me this, so I'm gonna read this. This is by Jorge Luis Borges. It's called Leyenda. And I read this, and it made me think about how much we've gone through as a community in Arizona and how we've, even in our own communities, have hurt each other and suffered fallouts. And we're just gearing up to go back at it again, so I thought this was appropriate. Leyenda. Abel and Cain meet again after Abel's death. They were walking in the desert and knew each other from a distance, for both men were very tall. The brothers sat on the ground, made a fire, and ate. For a while, they were untalkative, the way tired men can be after a long day working. This phone's terrible. In the sky, some still unnamed star appeared by the firelight. Cain made out the mark of the stone on Abel's forehead, dropped the food in his mouth, and asked to be forgiven for his crime. I no longer remember, did you kill me or was it I who killed you? Abel answered, here we are together again, just as we used to be. Now I know for sure you've forgiven me, said Cain. Because to forget is to have forgiven. I'll try my best to forget too. Yes, said Abel, speaking slowly. You're right. As long as there's remorse, there's guilt. Thank you.
I'm going to do it too. It's okay, Myrlin. this is Audre Lorde's Poetry is Not a Luxury, remixed with Pat Parker's poem I Have a Dream and my own words. Poetry is not a luxury. It is not only dream or vision, is the skeleton architecture of our lives, is the way we help give name to the nameless so it can be thought, is a vital necessity of our existence, forms the quality of light within which we predicate our hopes and dreams toward survival and change, first made into language, then into idea, then into more tangible action. Pat Parker, I have a dream. No, not Martin's. In my dream, I can go into a public bathroom and not be shrieked at by ladies. In my dream, I can walk ghetto streets and not be beaten up by my brothers. I too have a dream. It's a simple dream. Myself, I too have dreams. Many dreams. Yes, one for Martin. Yes, one for Pat Parker. Yes, one for each of my black and brown and sometimes queer students who text, who message, who call, crying, post-pulse, post-election season, seeming to have opened season on their bodies. Post-Charleston church shooting, post another black body, blood, blooming red Rorschach, impression left on all of us who see it in whatever way we want. When my student, when I am afraid to dare speak, when we are all waiting for the next shooter, the next slaughter, the next trigger to be pulled on more legislation aimed at our bodies, all I can offer is a dream made poem, is my own story, is the ways we come into contact with one another. In the forefront of our move toward change, there is only our poetry to hint at possibility made real. Our poems formulate the implications of ourselves, what we feel within and dare make real, or bring into action into accordance with our fears, our hopes, our most cherished terrors. For within structures defined by profit, by linear power, by institutional dehumanization, our feelings were not meant to survive. There are no new pains. We have felt them all already. We have hidden that fact in the same place where we have hidden our power. They lie in our dreams. And it is in our dreams that point the way to freedom. They are made realizable through our poems that give us strength and courage to see, to feel, to speak, and to dare.
I'm Alberto Ríos. Increíble. You should see this from my perspective, how full this room is, how wonderful that feels. I'm going to start by reading a shocking poem, one of America's foundational poems. This is the poem called The New Colossus that's on the Statue of Liberty. If you have not read this in a while, you will be shocked. This is called The New Colossus. It's written by Emma Lazarus in 1883. Not like the brazen giant of Greek fame, with conquering limbs astride from land to land. Here, at our sea-washed sunset gates, shall stand a mighty woman with a torch, whose flame is the imprisoned lightning, and her name, Mother of Exiles. From her beacon hand glows worldwide welcome. Her mild eyes command the air-bridged harbor that twin cities frame. Keep, ancient lands, your storied pomp, cries she with silent lips. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. The wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed, to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. You'll note she talks about a golden door, not a golden wall. I'm going to read a poem about the border wall, about that idea. This was written for the visit of Presidente Vicente Fox when he came here, who has adamantly said he's not going to pay for that wall. Perhaps you've heard that. But I also want to read this for my father. My father was born in Mexico. He came to this country and he became a judge. That's been in the news lately. The integrity of my father. I'm going to read this as I read it first time it was presented. It is now inscribed at the border in Nogales, at the Mariposa Crossing. It's called Border Lines, Líneas Fronterizas. A weight carried by two weighs only half as much. Un peso cargado por dos no pesa más que la mitad. The world on a map looks like the drawing of a cow in a butcher's shop. All those lines showing where to cut. El mundo en un mapa parece el dibujo de una vaca en la carnicería. Todas esas líneas mostrando dónde cortar. Pero ese dibujo de la vaca es también un rompecabezas mostrando cómo todas las piezas extrañas caben muy bien juntas. But that drawing of a cow is also a jigsaw puzzle, showing just as much how very well all the strange parts fit together. La manera en que miramos el dibujo nos hace ver la diferencia. Which way we look at the drawing makes all the difference. Parecemos vivir en un mundo de mapas, pero en verdad vivimos en un mundo hecho no de papel ni de tinta, sino de gente. Esas líneas son nuestras vidas. We seem to live in a world of maps, but in truth we live in a world made not of paper and ink, but of people. Those lines are our lives. Juntos, demos vuelta al mapa hasta que veamos claramente. La frontera es lo que nos une, no lo que nos separa. Together, let us turn the map until we see clearly the border is what joins us, not what separates us. And I'm going to finish. I'd like to give you some national news. Resistance, we can as writers resist, but the next step is getting together, organizing, doing something. And 20 of the top arts organizations have gotten together and are starting a poetry coalition. And immigration is going to be its first year theme. And it's an exciting way to think about how resistance might move toward something, toward action, and action toward good result. Not just result, but good result. Well, we don't always win. And as I've been thinking about what's coming this week, I don't know how to feel. And this next poem came from, I was trying to think about who the good guys are and who the bad guys are and how do they all fit into my world. And it's getting confusing. This is a poem, just so ever so loosely, about bullying in all of its forms and uniforms that it might take. And when bullying becomes powerful, and when power becomes destructive. This is called When the Ghosts Stay. You have terror, and I have tears. In this cruel way, we are for each other. We are at war. You always win. but I do not go away. You shoot me again. Again, I do not go away. You shoot with bullets, but you have nothing else. I fight back. I shoot you with fragments of childhood where you played the hero. I shoot you with memories of your mother and your little sister, Maritza. I shoot you with spring in the rolling mountains and the taste of plantain bananas and sugar. You do not fall down dead. You can kill me where all I can do is hold up the mirror of remembering to you, the mirror of everything you have done. You set fire to me with gasoline. I set fire to you with the memory of your first love. You cut my hands off. I cut your hands off with the way you saw them disappear when he was diving into the warm water of the lake the summer of swimming with your brother. Do you remember the names of the left for dead, the damaged, the hounded, the hurt? Do you remember my name? Your fist is hard. My name is crying. You strike a match. My name is cringe. You lift your foot. My name is pain. You wake up. My name is closed eyes. Your smile mimics the size of the opening on the side of a head, a crude opening that a mean needle will stitch up tonight. Your arm laughs at me with its muscle. All this, all these tears you have made, this water you have found in the desert, all this blood you have drawn from the bodies of so many who needed it. You win. You have always won. All I can do is not go away. Not go away is my name. Thank you.
I'm Cynthia Hogue, and I've put together an assemblage, and Alison Hawthorne Deming is going to read with me. She will be Langston Hughes. I want to thank Sally Ball for putting this together, and Alberto Ríos for reminding us that we are not going to go away, and humanities and the arts and our literary heritage, which records that history and these feelings, are not going to go away. The first is a paragraph from the great African-American historian, Eric Foner. The time has come to reintroduce integration into our political vocabulary, not as a code for whites dictating to blacks or as colorblindness, a term appropriated from the civil rights movements by conservatives and made into an empty slogan, but as a vision of a nation transformed, one in which equality is a reality for all Americans. Democracy, by Langston Hughes, will be read by Alison and interspersed with revised excerpts from Asphodel, That Greeny Flower by William Carlos Williams, and I will read that.
Democracy will not come today, this year, nor ever, through compromise and fear.
I come, my sweet, to sing to you. My heart rouses thinking to bring you news of something that concerns you and concerns many.
I have as much right as the other fellow has to stand on my two feet and own the land.
Look at what passes for the news. You will not find truth there, but in despised poems.
I tire so of hearing people say, let things take their course, tomorrow is another day. I do not need my freedom when I'm dead. I cannot live on tomorrow's bread.
It is difficult to get the news from poems, yet men die miserably every day for lack of what is found there. Hear me out.
Freedom is a strong seed planted in a great need. I live here too. I want freedom just as you.
Dead power is everywhere among us. In the forest, chopping down the songs, at night in the industrial landscape, wasting and stiffening the new life, in the streets of the city, throwing away the day. We wanted something different for our people, not to find ourselves an old reactionary republic full of ghost fears, the fears of death and the fears of birth. We want something else. Muriel Rukeyser, The Life of Poetry.
I do not need my freedom when I'm dead. I cannot live on tomorrow's bread. Thank you, Cynthia. Thank you all for being here and sharing this sense of community today. I'm going to read three pieces. First, a poem by Denise Levertov, one of our great poet activists who through the 60s, 70s, and 80s was one of the great voices for the anti-Vietnam War movement, for anti-nuclear proliferation and social justice. This is her poem, Making Peace. A voice from the dark called out, the poets must give us imagination of peace to oust the intense, familiar imagination of disaster. Peace, not only the absence of war, but peace, like a poem, is not there ahead of itself, can't be imagined before it is made, can't be known except in the words of its making, grammar of justice, syntax of mutual aid. A feeling towards it, dimly sensing a rhythm, is all we have until we begin to utter its metaphors, learning them as we speak. A line of peace might appear if we restructured the sentence our lives are making, revoked its reaffirmation of profit and power, questioned our needs, allowed long pauses. A cadence of peace might balance its weight on that different fulcrum, peace, a presence, an energy field more intense than war, might pulse then, stanza by stanza, into the world. Each act of living, one of its words, each word, a vibration of light, facets of the forming crystal. A very short passage from Barack Hussein Obama. We, the people, recognize that we have responsibilities as well as rights. Not that our destinies are bound together, that a freedom which only asks what's in it for me, a freedom without a commitment to others, a freedom without love or charity or duty or patriotism, is unworthy of our founding ideals and those who died in their defense. And finally, I'll read an excerpt from a piece that I wrote called Letter to America, which I wrote a few days after the election, that great destabilizing moment. We have seen language used to manipulate people, distort reality, deny facts, and betray our American ideals of liberty and justice. We need now to believe in the power of language to help us connect across our distances, express empathy form new alliances, fuel our better natures, and live more fully the values we espouse. Surely, surprising acts of resistance will rise from the spirit of resilience and solidarity, energized by our grief. Maybe all the women who attend the Women's March next weekend should wear the hijab in solidarity with those who feel the very real vulnerability arising from the threatening rhetoric of the day. I think of this, remembering the symbolic power of an action taken just days after the terrorist attacks in Paris in November 2015, when public protests were banned. 10,000 pairs of shoes were lined up in the Place de la République. Shoes from Pope Francis, shoes from the Dalai Lama, shoes of the living and shoes of the dead, they stood in for the 200,000 people anticipated to gather on Paris streets ahead of the climate summit. So sure, take to the streets, sign petitions, call legislators, move to a red state or stay in one, and run for the school board. Do not go to Canada. Donate to organizations that work on the local level or promote human rights. Think of the great spirit of inventiveness the earth calls forth after every major disturbance it suffers. Be artful, inventive, and just, my friends, but do not be silent. Thank you.
My name is Andrea Avery. I'm going to read some passages from Nancy Mayer's book, Waist High in the World. She was a very important and personally inspiring voice to me. We lost her in the Grim Reaper year, 2016. But I know some of her friends are in the audience, and I hope these words mean as much to all of you as they do to me. Without explicit invitation, I have no right to enter your home, which has, by long-standing tradition, been assigned a figurative moat, drawbridge, and portcullis in case I forget myself. But I ought to be admitted to any place to which the general populace commonly has access. Restaurants, surely, as well as banks, churches, theaters, and cinemas, the post office, dry cleaning shops, beauty salons, and above all, the mall. You'd think that a capitalist society would eagerly grasp this principle without legal intervention. The more goods and services I can readily reach, the more likely I am to spend my money. In reality, legislation has often been required to ensure access, which has been slow to be established and is still far from perfect. The Americans with Disabilities Act, ADA, of 1990, federally mandating equal opportunity for people with physical and mental impairments, has only begun to have some discernible effects. If I'm to make my contribution to capitalism, of course, I must have some money of my own to spend. According to one magazine article, a staggering 67% of the 43 million Americans with disabilities are unemployed, and 82% of those individuals want to work rather than live on the dole. Employment was one of the major issues ADA was designed to address. It requires employers to hire qualified personnel without regard to disability and to make modifications as long as those do not impose undue hardship to accommodate their special needs. Employers balk mechanically at mandates, as a friend from high school who owns his own business made clear one evening, claiming that such a law threatened to bankrupt him. He didn't even fall under its provisions, I had to point out to him, since he had fewer than the 25 employees originally required for it to take force, or even the 15 to which the limit has now been lowered. And the undue hardship clause protects businesses from unreasonable levels of expense. Moreover, many modifications, a ramp to a door, say, don't cost a great deal, but if done properly, last virtually forever, so that my friend himself, should he suffer a stroke years hence, might benefit from work done now. My great concern I'm skipping around. You all should read this book, though. My great concern is that in an era when peevish voters press for a different quick fix with every election, unnerved legislators will jettison the Americans with Disabilities Act long before the new conditions it mandates can work more than superficial change in either the lives of the disabled or the attitudes of the non-disabled. Directives are essential until the standards they put into place come to seem so natural that behaviors are permanently altered. But such transformation is not going to occur in the couple of years between national elections, when one set of bums gets thrown out and another set sweeps in, promising to reverse whatever their predecessors put into place. Currently, governmental protection of the powerless is unfashionable, and in the tempestuous drive to get rid of big government, I can well imagine Congress proudly pitching ADA overboard. I remember reading a passage in which William F. Buckley Jr., describing a visit to his mother, commented how sweet she always smelled, despite her deterioration in old age, and snapping to myself, of course she smells sweet. A nurse looks after her 24 hours a day. Put her in a county nursing home for a week and see how sweet she smells. Power and privilege dangerously insulate policymakers from the real needs of their constituents. One day, it may seem as silly to build a structure without a ramp as it would be to leave off a set of steps today, but at the moment, people must be told to do so, or they'll simply forget. Legislation like ADA, designed to establish the civil rights of a population hitherto assumed to be a little less than kin, must counter centuries of habitual neglect, exclusion, and worse. Only half a century ago, after all, physical and mental defectives were exterminated in Nazi Germany alongside homosexuals and Jews. Historically, the treatment of the disabled has generally stopped short, by at least a couple of inches, of outright atrocity. And most people in the United States would protest against the torture and killing of a young mentally retarded woman, although if she were instead raped by a group of high school students, at least some would rationalize that boys will be boys, and anyway, she asked for and even liked it. Why even bring up the subject of monstrosity, my husband asks, when I condemn Nazi efforts to purge the state of people with physical and mental defects? No one will disagree with you there. He's right, I hope. At least, I would not expect anyone I'm likely to meet to view medical experimentation without consent, forced sterilization, or the slaughter of innocents, or any of the rest of us, for that matter, as anything but unconscionable violations of human rights. In this sense, I am not looking for argument, I assure you. But I would expect, because I regularly encounter the sort of socially hygienic attitudes toward people with disabilities that might have permitted otherwise compassionate human beings to acquiesce in, or at least to overlook, such desecration of human life. These attitudes may be held, often unawares, by people so well-meaning and unscrupulous, that they would be aghast to have their opinions associated, even tenuously, with the atrocities of an indubitably mad dictator obsessed with the purity of his race. These are my realities, and some of them nearly break my heart. Some of them don't. I will never wield a mop again, after all, or scrub another toilet bowl. My grief is selective. But it is not the world's task to assuage whatever genuine sorrows darken my spirit. I know this. I think most people with disabilities do. In asking that the entrance to a building be ramped, that the numbers on an elevator panel be brailled, that emergency services be equipped to communicate with people who cannot hear or speak clearly, no one expects all impediments to be miraculously whisked away. In insisting that others view our lives as ample and precious, we are not demanding that they be made perfect. There are rewards for making the world physically and emotionally accessible to all people, including benefits that accrue to society as a whole. The more perspectives that can be brought to bear on human experience, even from the slant of a wheelchair or a hospital bed, or through the ears of a blind person or the fingers of someone who is deaf, the richer that experience becomes. If it is both possible and pleasant for me and my kind to enter, the world will become a livelier place. You'll see. Thank you.
My name is Farid Matouk. It's a Syrian name. I'm the child of a Syrian Peruvian woman and a Peruvian man, a mestizo man. I was born in Lima, Peru, came to the United States in 1980, overstayed our visa. We were undocumented until immigration reform was passed in 1987. We came, though, because my mother was getting away from domestic abuse. She preemptively kidnapped me so that we could get here. So in that sense, I guess, like a lot of us, I'm a refugee from a country that doesn't exist, which is the country of women. So I share that background to say that I look for my models in a lot of places. And one of the places where I find that, a model for how to think and also actually how to write poetry, even though she writes in prose, is in the work of the African-American scholar Horton Spillers. I'm going to read two paragraphs from the beginning of this essay from 1987 called Mama's Baby, Papa's Maybe. Dr. Spillers is writing very specifically from the perspective of an African-American woman. But if our experiences are different in degree, then by some measure of those degrees, or if our experiences are different in kind, then by some overlap of our kind. What she says here speaks to me and I think to a lot of folks. Let's face it, writes Dr. Spillers, I am a marked woman, but not everybody knows my name. Peaches and brown sugar, sapphire and earth mother, auntie, granny, God's holy fool, and Miss Ebony First, or black woman at the podium. I describe a locus of confounded identities, a meeting ground of investments and privations in the national treasury of rhetorical wealth. My country needs me, and if I were not here, I would have to be invented. W.E.B. Du Bois predicted earlier than 1903 that the 20th century would be the century of the color line. We could add to this spatio-temporal configuration another thematic of analogously terrible weight. If the black woman can be seen as a particular figuration of the split subject psychoanalytic theory posits, then Du Bois' century marks the site of its profoundest revelation. The problem before us is deceptively simple. The terms enclosed in quotation marks in the preceding paragraph isolate overdetermined nominative properties. Embedded in bizarre axiological ground, they demonstrate a sort of telegraphic coding. They are markers so loaded with mythical prepossession that there is no easy way for the agents buried beneath them to come clean. In that regard, the names by which I am called in the public place render an example of signifying property plus. In order for me to speak a truer word concerning myself, I must strip down through layers of attenuated meanings made in excess in time, over time, assigned by a particular historical order, and there await marvels of my own inventiveness. The Child Development Group of Mississippi was an early Head Start program. It functioned from 65 to 67, sometimes with federal funding, sometimes not, because it was so controversial. I'm grateful to the poet and scholar Fred Moten, who called my attention to this book, which is a biased history of the Child Development Group of Mississippi, so self-named. The book is The Devil Has Slippery Shoes. There's an appendix in the back that speaks actually about a ministry called the Delta Ministry. I'm going to read three paragraphs from this and then close. The Delta Ministry was 15 paid people, many of them ministers, over 300 out-of-state volunteers who came to live and work in Mississippi, and a group of local African-American volunteers who worked for $15 a week, all led by the remarkable Art Thomas. And there's, I think, something in these three paragraphs, two and a half paragraphs, about how works how groups can work together in this moment. The Delta Ministry believed that working for love and justice, traditional goals of the churches, is only meaningful when new concepts of ministry and new action methods, which are responsive to today's revolutionary situation, are adopted and invented. The Delta Ministry started with specific incidents that arose in the lives of individuals. It tried to see them through from roots to real solution. It was a group that was willing to work shoulder to shoulder and brain to brain with people, not for them or on them. It helped them fight through their problems, one by heavily burdensome one, as they cropped up and came to a festering head. The strength people gained from discovering that social institutions and warm white individuals could be on their side can't be overestimated. The presence of the Delta Ministry also affected the white community. Ministers, businessmen, and civic leaders rejected most of the consistent efforts Delta Ministry workers made to interpret their work and to work through and with the power structure. Yet, at the rate that they attacked Delta Ministry with newspaper blasts and occasional shotgun blasts, the moderates among them were able to come out from hiding and do many decent and moderate things which they had wanted to do before, but were under too much fire to dare to do. The Delta Ministry served as a lightning rod to catch some of the bitter criticism always showered lavishly on those who moved in Mississippi. The Delta Ministry became the presence, the Delta Ministry became the presence on the far end of the continuum that runs between racist reactionaries and social reformers. Then the Mississippi moderates, who used to be regarded by their state mates as radical reds and who could do nothing for fear it would further exaggerate this wild-eyed image, found themselves regarded as the only group ready and able to save the sovereign state from deadly dangerous outside agitators. In this case, a bunch of mild-mannered ministers. Besides being an invaluable presence representing dignity and decency for each person in a state which was, for black people, a barbarically brutal police state using all the well-known terrorist tactics, the Delta Ministry engaged in a wide variety of excellent programs because of its philosophy that a ministry of service to relieve suffering and a ministry of community development in today's Mississippi must, to be really meaningful, get into basic issues of voting, education, jobs, politics. The Delta Ministry was usually in hot water with cool Mississippians, cool white Mississippians, and cautious segments of sponsoring churches elsewhere. And I'll close with a Smithsonian recording of the actual work that the Child Development Group did with children.
Just the other day, said the freedom fighters were on their way, and they came by bus and an airplane too. They'll even walk if you ask them to. Oh, Johnson, you know you. Alone. And he didn't take nothing I bought a sling and a stone. Little David was just a shepherd's boy. Then he killed Goliath.
Thanks.
If that doesn't give you hope for the future, then I don't know what would. I just wanted to say a quick thank you to Sally for putting us all in this room today. She's a very important woman, and so is Erin Ballou, who started the Writers Resist movement the day after the elections. And so we wouldn't be here if it weren't for those two wonderful women and ourselves, you know, wanting better for ourselves. So speaking to the future, I'm going to read a poem by Erin. Ars Poetica for the future. The rapture came and went without incident, but I put off folding my laundry just in case. Also, from my inbox this morning, subject header, lesbian torture camps. The mind ricochets like a fly. Is there anything left for people to do to people? Meanwhile, my boyfriend looks forward to the apocalypse as a retirement party. He pretends he won't be attending, like the characters in the movie who climb the highest building, wanting to be the first to welcome the spaceship. In this world, I've given up sleep for dreaming, and art is still our only flying car. But I can't recall when anticipation became the substitute for hope. Recently, C said, "Now we begin the poems of our great middle period." I imagine digging a series of small holes, burying poems in Ziploc baggies. I imagine them as baby teeth knocked from the present's mouth. And so I'm going to read my first post-election poem that I wrote that I would put in a baggie and place in the ground. And the title is actually a quote from the president-elect, which I'm sure you've heard. When Mexico sends its people, they're not sending their best. One, my father is not a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a bad one. Two, my mother is not a rapist or a drugger or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a drug trafficker or a criminal or a killer or a rapist or a bad one either. Three, when America elects a president, they are not electing their best. When America elects a president, they are not electing their best. When America elects a president, they are not electing their best. When America elects a president, they are not electing their best. When America elects a president, they are not electing their best. When America elects a president, they are not electing their best. When America elects a president, they are not electing their best, though they've not yet begun to hear me scream. Thank you.
I'm Jess Bernquist. I don't ever want to read without musical accompaniment again. It's like a heartbeat. It's beautiful. Two brief pieces. The first is from a new series, Post-Election. I'm obsessed with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. There are 30 of them. No one has figured out yet how to enforce them. The poems that I'm writing are about each article, but from the perspective of birds. Article 6, Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Everyone has the right to recognition everywhere as a person before the law. Tawny-shouldered blackbird, Guantanamo Bay. My love and I sing a dual song. Three dits, three daws, three dits into the space where sky and water meet, or to one another in the brush, our cupped nest. She flies me to the caged land where men have no names, where men speak their stories to iron and cement. One man sits with his head resting in the nest his hands make, and he calls our song so carefully, I almost mistake him for my love. Another man yells at him, fool, SOS will only be answered by the birds. The evening sky turns an alarming pink on the night he sings loudest. I answer him because he asks, and to deny his song is to deny a song straining to be heard by another, any other. And then I will just read brief excerpts from Charlie Chaplin's final speech in The Great Dictator. 1940, because I just have to. In this world, there is room for everyone, and the good earth is rich and can provide for everyone. The way of life can be free and beautiful, but we have lost the way. Greed has poisoned men's souls, has barricaded the world with hate, has goose-stepped us into misery and bloodshed. We have developed speed, but we have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives abundance has left us in want. Our knowledge has made us cynical, our cleverness hard and unkind. We think too much and feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent and all will be lost. To those who can hear me, I say, do not despair. The misery that is now upon us is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. The hate of men will pass, and dictators die, and the power they took from the people will return to the people. In the name of democracy, let us all unite. Let us fight for a new world, a decent world that will give humankind a chance to work, that will give youth a future and old age a security. By the promise of these things, brutes have risen to power, but they lie. They do not fulfill that promise. They never will. Dictators free themselves, but they enslave the people. Now let us fight to fulfill that promise. Let us fight to free the world, to do away with national barriers, to do away with greed, with hate and intolerance. Let us fight for a world of reason, a world where science and progress will lead to all men's happiness. Soldiers, in the name of democracy, let us all unite. Thank you.
Can you hear me all right here? Right. I'm just going to read three short poems by other people. They're all sort of about, I think, the same kind of thing. One of the things I've been thinking about a lot as a writer and as a person is about the way in which I want to be political, or the way I want my politics to express itself in my art and in my life. And one of the problems I have with that is I think the thing that animates me quickest politically is my anger. My anger expresses first and most powerfully. And one of the things I've become really aware of this election cycle is that, and I don't want to speak for anybody else here, but the things that I feel like I'm resisting or things that I'm here in resistance to are forces that I think feed off our anger powerfully. They want it, they crave it, they build off it. And what they don't want, what they're that really are opposed to is our joy and our curiosity, in our wonder, in our love for each other, in all the ways they don't want us to do those things. And I think that's something that I'm more and more trying to figure out in my own work, in my own life, and I think is worth thinking about as we go forward. It's easy to bully each other into focusing on our anger, I think. Social media does it so easily. Like, why don't you care about this? Why don't you care about this? Why are you posting these other things? We have to feel those other things. We have to feel delight and joy and wonder. Always. I think those things are really important. So the three poems I'm going to read, I think are all about that in some way. And I'll have that tension sort of in them. And I'll just say, not being a poet myself, that ordering poetry is always really interesting to me. And I think there was a way to order these three poems in which they would end very, like, sort of accusatory. And I've tried to end them instead in a way that I think leads in a more hopeful direction. This is Ilya Kaminsky's We Lived Happily During the War. We lived happily during the war, and when they bombed other people's houses, we protested, but not enough. We opposed them, but not enough. I was in my bed, around my bed, America was falling, invisible house by invisible house by invisible house. I took a chair outside and watched the sun. In the 6 month of a disastrous rain, in the house of money, in the street of money, in the city of money, in the country of money, our great country of money, we, forgive us, lived happily during the war. This is Jack Gilbert's A Brief for the Defense. Sorrow everywhere, slaughter everywhere. If babies are not starving somewhere, they are starving. I'm sorry. If babies are not starving someplace, they are starving somewhere else, with flies in their nostrils. But we enjoy our lives because that's what God wants. Otherwise, the mornings before summer dawn would not be made so fine. The Bengal tiger would not be fashioned so miraculously well. The poor women at the fountain are laughing together between the suffering they have known and the awfulness in the future, smiling and laughing while someone in the village is very sick. There is laughter every day in the streets of Calcutta, and the women laugh in the cages of Bombay. If we deny our happiness, resist our satisfaction, we lessen the importance of our deprivation. We must risk delight. We can do without pleasure, but not delight, not enjoyment. We must have the stubbornness to accept our gladness in the ruthless furnace of this world. To make injustice the only measure of our attention is to praise the devil. If the locomotive of the Lord runs us down, we should give thanks that the end had magnitude. We must admit there will be music despite everything. We stand at the prow again of a small ship, anchored late at night in the tiny port, looking over to the sleeping island. The waterfront is three shuttered cafes and one naked light burning. To hear the faint sound of oars in the silence as a rowboat comes slowly out and then goes back is truly worth all the years of sorrow that are to come. And the last poem I'm going to read is Ada Limón's What It Looks to Us and the Words We Use. All these great barns out here in the outskirts, black creosote boards knee deep in the bluegrass. They look so beautifully abandoned, even in use. You say they look like arcs after the seas dried up. I say they look like pirate ships. And I think of that walk in the valley where Jay said, "You don't believe in God." And I said, "No. I believe in this connection we all have to nature, to each other, to the universe." And she said, "Yeah, God." And how we stood there, low beasts, among the white oaks, Spanish moss and spiderwebs, obsidian shards stuck in our pockets, woodpecker flurry, and I refused to call it so. So instead, we looked up at the unruly sky, its clouds in simple animal shapes we could name, though we knew they were really just clouds, disorderly and marvelous and ours. Thank you.
And I know you're going to do this, Sally, but I have to do it too. And that is the brilliant artist, inventor, musician, incredible human being, Joe Willie Smith. This piece was written, or actually delivered, in 1851 at the Women's Convention in Akron, Ohio, by a woman who was born into slavery, who was a women's rights activist as well as an abolitionist, Sojourner Truth. Well, children, where there is so much racket, there must be something out of kilter. I think that twixt the Negroes of the South and the women at the North, all talking about rights, the white men will be in a fix pretty soon. But what's all this here talking about? That man over there, he says that women need to be helped in the carriages and lifted over ditches and to have the best place everywhere. Nobody ever helps me into carriages or over mud puddles or gives me any best place. And ain't I a woman? Look at me. Look at my arm. I have plowed and planted and gathered into barns and no man could head me. And ain't I a woman? I could work as much and eat as much as a man when I could get it and bear the lash as well. And ain't I a woman? I have borne 13 children and seen most all sold off into slavery. And when I cried out with my mother's grief, none but Jesus heard me. And ain't I a woman? Then they talk about this thing in the head what do they call that? Yeah, intellect. That's it. What's that got to do with a woman's rights or Negro's rights? If my cup won't hold but a pint and yours hold a quart, wouldn't you be mean not to let me have my little half measure full? Then that little man in black, right there, he says women can't have as much rights as men because Christ wasn't a woman. Where did your Christ come from? Where did your Christ come from? From God and a woman. Man had nothing to do with him. If the first woman God ever made was strong enough to turn the world upside down all alone, these women together ought to be able to turn it back and get it right side up again. And now they asking to do it. The men better let them. Obliged to you for hearing me. And now, old Sojourner ain't got nothing more to say.
Thank you, Sally, and thank you all for staying in solidarity today. I'm Rosemarie, this is Joy Young again, and we're the final readers.
A Superfund site is any land in the United States that has been contaminated by hazardous waste and identified by the EPA as a candidate for cleanup because it poses a risk to human health and or the environment. There are currently 14 Superfund sites in the state of Arizona.
Diane DePrima's Revolutionary Letter, number 16. We are eating up the planet.
Apache Power.
The New
Company.
York Times takes a forest every
Tharco
Sunday.
Hayden plant.
Los Angeles draws its
Cyprus
water from the Sacramento Valley.
Mine.
The rivers of British Columbia are ours on lease for 99 years.
Bend, wash area.
Every large factory is an infringement of our God-given right to light and air, to clean and flowing rivers stocked with fish, to the very possibility of life for our children's children.
Mountain View mobile home estates.
We will have to look carefully. I.e., do we really want, need electricity? And at what cost in natural resource or human resource do we need cars when petroleum pumped from the earth poisons the land around for 100 years? Or try this statistic. The U.S. has 5% of the world's people, uses over 50% of the world's goods. Our garbage holds matter for survival for uncounted, underdeveloped nations.
It is a truly staggering sight to see so many people in this room. Thank you guys all for coming so much to Writers Resist. We are now exiting the library as it is closed. It is the end of the day. They are closed tomorrow. But as you leave, please do continue to think about your resistance, your relationships to other people, and how we as members of multiple communities can come together and continue to advance the causes that were so articulately espoused today. So thank you.